Hello and welcome to AXSChat. I'm delighted that we're joined today by Hilary Wall, who's a partner at BCG, Boston Consulting Group. I'm really pleased that Hilary's here because I quote a piece of Hilary's work all the time. She's done some research on self-identity and disability and the feeling of belonging. Urge that you check it out. We'll put the links up on our webpage. But Hilary and I first met at M Enabling Conference in Washington, D.C. last year. Hit it off, been talking about stuff ever since. Really thought it would be great to have Hilary on the podcast. So great to have you here, Hilary. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, why you ended up doing research into disability in the workplace, et cetera, and then we'll take it from there.
Awesome. Neil, thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to chat with you all today. So my name is Hilary Wool. I am a partner at Boston Consulting Group based in Philadelphia. I work across our public sector and healthcare practices. So working on transformations to better serve constituents and patients, often through the lens of government agencies. I'm a co-founder of our Disability Employee Resource Group, ERG, called AXSChat at BCG. And so founded that about 5 or so years ago, and it's grown from a handful of folks to 1,500 or so staff members globally. And about a year and a half ago, I started leading our research for BCG focused on workplace of studies. I'm excited to talk more about that today. And then, you know, outside of that, I'm passionate about paratriathlon. I love being part of the disability community. I have Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and ankylosing spondylitis. I'm an ambulatory wheelchair user. And so, you know, this is all really, really close to my heart and, you know, certainly relevant to the work that I've done professionally and also personally.
Excellent. That's a really concise but very detailed intro. So can you tell us a little bit about this research that I so frequently quote? So I think that the headline figures that really got me and that are the conversation starters were that companies that the people work for that have responded to the survey generally report between that they think they have between 4 and 7% of their workforce as people with disabilities. And yet when people felt safe to be able to disclose disability or a long-term health condition, the numbers that were coming back as self-reporting were around 25%. So that's a huge difference between what the organizations think and what they actually have amongst their employee population. But there was plenty more to the report as well. So please, you know, tell us about that. And I know you followed up with a second report, which has just recently been published as well. So we'll dive into
Absolutely.
That as well.
I can share a few of the headlines and then we can dive in, and happy to talk a little bit about the follow-up work that we've recently done, which is focused on intersectionality, another one of my favorite topics to talk shop on. So Neil, yeah, as you said, companies are, you know, simply put, underestimating the share of their workforce that has a disability. And we know that companies make decisions, they make policy, right? They base their resourcing around data. And so that's one of the many reasons why I think this matters. We surveyed 28,000 employees across 16 countries, including the US, the UK, India, Australia, Germany, China. And you know, we asked as one of the questions, you know, indicate if you identify as having a disability or a major health condition impacting one or more life activities. And then there were some details under it. We used a pretty comprehensive definition of disability, which I think is one of the reasons that folks were, you know, willing to self-identify at a higher rate. But as you mentioned, we found in our data that 25% of the workforce at large organizations do identify as having a disability. People with disabilities, we saw in our survey, have lower feelings of workplace inclusion in every country that we surveyed. So we used a kind of a proprietary inclusion index that BCG has developed called the Bliss Index. And we saw that on average, employees with disabilities are about 3 points on this index lower than the average for non-disabled employees. And this relates to, you know, psychological safety, people feeling that they can bring themselves to work, like they have a sense of belonging at work. We saw that reported discrimination was higher, and many of the other measures that, you know, that you would unfortunately expect among people with disabilities. The positive finding, though, is that it's not inevitable for disabled employees to have a worse workplace experience. And we actually found that in the prevalence of three specific strategies, policies, interventions, that story can be flipped, and that inclusion gap can actually be closed and in some cases inverted. And so the three things that we found really make the biggest difference. One, something that we call an employee-centric DEI ecosystem. So do you have a chief diversity officer? Are you investing in employee resource groups for staff members of all identities? Are you incorporating programming? Are leaders openly talking about their support for employees with diverse identities? The second being mentorship. We saw that the inclusion gap actually closes when staff with disabilities have mentors, even mentors that don't necessarily share their identity or identities. And then the third is having access to employee-centric reasonable accommodations. So workplace adjustments that enable workers to fulfill the essential functions of their job. And we know that this is a particular pain point, across many organizations in many countries, even ones that do have legal frameworks and policies around that. So that's the maybe a little bit longer short snippet of like the critical things we found in that study.
Hillary, thank you for the work. We really appreciate it. And I think we need more of this type of work and coming from a lot of different groups. I am curious about the comprehensive definition that you talked about, because I know that the Americans with Disabilities Act is a broader definition of disabilities than, for example, the definition in the Convention of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you used both of those legislations, but or both of those definitions, but.
Yeah, and so, yeah, thank you for raising that. So our definition includes, as I alluded to, all people who self-identify as having a disability, a health condition or challenge that limits one or more major life activities. And we provided some examples in that, in that kind of drop down when folks were filling out the survey to be as expansive as possible. Including physical disabilities, psychological and mental health conditions, chronic illnesses, neurological conditions, and both visible and invisible conditions. So we really try to, spell out for our survey takers, our participants, like here are the many different categories that of which one or more may impact your daily life.
All right. And another thing that I'm fascinated with the 16 countries that you selected, because and I know we talked about this a little bit off air, but it's fascinating because countries are doing it different depending on what's happening in their cultures. And so I think it's interesting that you included the United States. We're making a lot of efforts, not getting it right, but we're getting some things right and we're learning on others. The UK, Australia, but you included China and India, for example. I heard those two countries, and I'll look to see who all the 16 are, but it seems like there's also an opportunity to figure out a bunch of things almost culturally. I am building an organization called Billion Dash Strong to bring together the billion people with lived experiences with disabilities, many who don't want to identify. So it's challenging, but we find people are treated differently in different countries. And because countries certainly have different priorities, we understand, but we're seeing some countries that just really are not meaningfully including people with disabilities and empowering them as others are. I still think all the countries have plenty to do. But I was just curious if you found, because of the countries that you selected, if you found any parts of it that wound up being interesting, you know, because once again, we have assumptions of how certain countries are doing things, but I still think there's a lot of data that needs to be done about what's really happening. I still think that we don't really completely understand the dynamics of all these intense nuances.
Absolutely. So I really appreciate you bringing that up. And, you know, we have a view where we show kind of country by country what that kind of inclusion gap looked like to non-disabled workers. And while across all countries, it was lower than non-disabled employees, there were some disparities that we saw. And I think a lot of that does reflect the, you know, stigmatization of people with disabilities. If you double click into the specific type of disability, we know that in certain countries, mental health is, you know, really, really stigmatized, and it's very difficult for people to admit, you know, openly or even on an anonymous survey, right, being impacted by a mental health condition. And so some of that we saw play out. But if you go to the survey, and all this is online, we've got the kind of the picture and the rankings. You may be surprised, you know, for example, India fell right next to the UK and the Nordics, right? You know, China, which was the lowest in terms of the biggest gap between disabled and non-disabled, was right there next to Germany, France, and South Africa. And the top three, Brazil, Japan, and Spain, you know, all have really different kind of histories and narratives and current states in terms of where we are. And so while there are some differences, some of that, you know, links to known, you know, stigmas or gaps or where policy stands, I think there were some elements that might be more surprising, that certain, you know, emerging market countries and, you know, OECD countries are actually right there next to each other in terms of how their employees are feeling.
Right, which is very exciting. I know Antonio has a question, but I just want to say also that I would assume, just based on the work I'm doing and what we're dealing with, I would assume that you had probably more people respond from, say, the U.S. and the U.K. than you did from China and India. So I know that we have to consider, you know, that as well as we're trying to do this data. Thank goodness you are doing it, because we need more of this done. But I think also we just still aren't getting the numbers of people, you know, really responding to what's happening in their countries as well. So I know you mentioned earlier, that's something you showed as well, how many responses you got in those countries, correct?
And all that information in depth is in the report. The number of respondents was, you know, different in each country depending on the response rates and other factors.
Right, yeah. Right. Thank you. Antonio?
No, using my sociologist act, you know, it's if you look at the way how that data is collected from the different censuses around the world, it makes it really, really difficult to for people with disabilities to identify themselves when they fill in the census. And if we compare countries, it's almost impossible to do a comparative study using census data, considering how different the questions are.
Right. Right.
However, we have other elements of data, you know, how many people in the world need contact lenses or glasses, you know, or around 64% of the population in certain countries have this need. Now, there's a recent study that identifies that 3.4 billion people worldwide have experienced some kind of neurological conditions. So we have this, we are looking for data with people with disabilities, organizations look into that, but how do we factor this external data that point to much higher numbers than sometimes we consider when we look at the workplace? Because we cannot separate people, the workplace from society. So how do we see organizations okay, it's good we have the numbers, but how can they see themselves as part of the society and as being as factoring the fact that there's much more people with disabilities out there than they might think?
Yeah. So thinking at this, I mean, great question and great point. I think it just speaks to the broader challenge. I know within the disability research community and business community, like the constant discussion and question around, data and quality data and, data, valid data and how to kind of compare across, whether that's countries, companies, industries. I think so two lenses. So one, from the standpoint of organizational leaders, and I think something I've said repeatedly in talking about this work, especially to business audiences, irrespective of what your company's internal data says, you have a lot of people with disabilities who work for you, and they are there no matter whether they are telling you they're there or not. They're there. And so you need to make policies and, have HR, initiatives and programs and considerations and, accommodations, like knowing that most likely about a quarter of your people have a disability. And that is vastly different from the perspective of, well, we're going to look at our internal data based on what it tells us. We're going to, prioritize or pretend, these people are here and these people are not. So I think that's the first lens. The second is, thinking about the constituents and customers that companies and organizations are serving. Your customers have disabilities. And so you need to think of that. I mean, this is going on to a little bit of a different topic, but in planning for, designing for, product management, we talk about this all the time, right? In the product management lifecycle, like you need to be doing that user research on the front end and considering accessibility, both digital and analog accessibility, like proactively in your design process and not waiting until someone says, hey, like I'm blind and I can't use this product.
Absolutely. Where do I start? So one of the reasons I really liked the reports was that it was statistically relevant, a significant number. So the survey had some weight to it, because a lot of the stats that get bandied about don't have, frankly, very good quality research behind them, and the methodology is poor. Mm-hmm. And that dilutes the quality of the argument that you can make, because if people can pick holes in your data, then they can data. Sorry, I'm going to stick with being British for a second. Then that starts to undermine all of the arguments you make based upon data. So having really good data is super. So thank you. Right, that's why I wanted you on here. Right,
labor of love. And I think just a quick comment, we waited like a number of years until we had our ERG up and running to start doing research and, do any kind of seat at the table activities. We're like, we need to get our house together internally before we, do this more broadly. But I think the reality is, organizations, like professional services, research organizations like BCG, we've got the capabilities to do research at this scale. On parallel with levels of universities and large institutions, but it takes a lot of time and budget and effort, and there's a need for it. And so it's that constant challenge of like, how do we, share resources across entities to get the right data and information out.
Absolutely, and the fact that you've got a tool that enables you, you've got an index tool and enables you to have that sort of statistical significance. I think what the reason I was commenting on this, and I'm keep going back to it, was you mentioned people want to know how many people, and we keep saying, what have we got internally? And I've worked with a number of our CEOs over the years. We've had a few, and it's the first question they ask, and it's a natural question to ask. Well, how many people are impacted? and you sort of go, well, we don't know, but it's more than you think. So having something that is well researched is really helpful. I mean, with our current CEO, Nordin, he asked that question, but was, you know, really well prepared to listen and understand why that wouldn't give him the answer that he wanted. So he went from asking that question from a, well, how many people are impacted point of view, to then understanding that we needed to create a culture of psychological safety. And then still wanting to gather the data, but it came for a different purpose. It was not, do I need to act, but can it tell me what are the things I need to act upon? And I think that that's the mind shift that we need to get, not just within, you know, company leadership, but also in those product teams that are developing things, that the teams that are doing the research. So it's not so much, do I have to do it, or is this going to prove that I can get away with not doing it? It's more, actually, can I gather the data that informs me on how to make the product better, how to serve people better? I mean, I think that shift in mindset's really important, and through continuing to build good reports based upon decent research and, you know, large data sets, that really helps us start to build that sort of that quality and build that into the way that companies think and operate and people think and operate as professionals. I know that Deborah, you had some comments, and then I think Antonio.
I do. I have comments for certainly Hillary, but Neil and Antonio, y'all come in too. But obviously, I have identity on the mind as I'm building this billion strong. But I do think it's a question that corporate employers, especially big corporate employers that are saying they want to include us, need to really think about. And not just from the lens of people with disabilities, speaking for just using that particular language, but why is our identity so important to employers? Why should big corporations, why should y'all even care how we choose or do not choose to identify in all the different parts that we identify as? Why does it matter? And why do we as the community have an obligation, or do we have an obligation to stand up and really talk about who we are so employers can get it better right? Because right now the employer's not really getting it right, but at the same time, we are not being fair as a community because we're saying, okay, jump higher. Nope, jump a little. We're not participating in as meaningfully as we should be. We have some people participating. We have a lot of Americans in the UK and people talking about it, but our community is not meaningfully really joining these conversations. I mean, I have questions, which I'm not going to ask you now because I know Antonio has a question, but about how you came up with the people to take the study. How much were we really, how do you even know how to get to us when we won't come out and identify, and 70 to 75% of us have hidden disabilities, and we have to tell you we are part of the community. So I think that's interesting, but at the same time, it goes into another word you use, the intersectionality and the different diverse groups. So I think there a question that we all do need to ask is why does identity matter at the end of the day? And I'll just throw a little point to it, and that something Antonio said to me. Antonio was born in Portugal. Antonio, English is not his first language. English is maybe his third language. I'm not sure, because I'm an American and I only speak one language. Come on, Americans. But at the same time, he was explaining to me as how these social media channels were changing and things were happening, how he was disadvantaged because he was not a native English speaker. Just picking on you for a second, Antonio, but we disadvantage people so much in so many different ways that it feels like that's part of the reason why we have to really figure out these identity questions. And I also know, and I won't say who did it, but a group, they went out to a whole bunch of CEOs of major corporations and really asked them if they themselves had a disability. Three or four of them identified that they did, but they would not disclose it. So once again, interesting dynamics and possible things to talk about. We're trying to, but I was just wondering if Hillary, you wanted to comment on that, maybe Neil and Antonio too, and then turn it over to Antonio.
So many, my brain is like firing in so many different directions. So let me, So a couple of threads that I wanted to pull on. I won't pull on all of them. So the piece about leadership, I spend a lot of time talking about this with my co-founder and mentor at, you know, within Accessibility at BCG, Brad Loftus, who's a quad, very senior partner in our organization. And there are not a lot of out disabled folks at the top of organizations, and especially corporate organizations in, you know, high powered industries, or, you know, however you want to frame it or call it, the C-suite, yada, yada. And we know that there are more, as you alluded to, Deborah, than are raising their hands. And so I think it's both a challenge of, you know, how do we, I mean, we know there's severe underrepresentation.
Right.
And so ensuring that we are taking proactive steps to make sure that retention and promotion is equitable at every step of the journey across disability, but also across, you know, every other, you know, demographic and identity lens as well. And then of the folks who are there at the top, I think it's about having that, you know, organizational environment that is supportive of diversity and openness at all levels. And also, like, folks with disabilities and leadership doing the work, you know, internally, like it's hard to be out and be like, hey, I might be the only, you know, one of my level who looks like, I mean, I am definitely the most senior, at least woman, most senior woman in my organization who's like a mobility device user. And that can feel really lonely sometimes. Yes. But you know what? Like, there's a couple of us at my peer organizations who are more junior than me. And I often kind of have this conversation with myself, like, if not you, then who? Like, you need to continue being vocal, being out there, because, you know, you don't want to create, like, you know, to perpetuate the same, you know, level of representation and narratives for the next generations to come. But it's hard. It's challenging. I think in terms of the, you know, why does I, like, philosophically, right? Like, practically, why does identity matter at all? So shifting gears to the second piece of research that we did. So this was, you know, a much narrower deep dive. We looked at intersectionality for people with disability in the workplace. And we only looked at the US context, just because race and ethnicity are so different in every country. And in some countries, it's not even legal to ask in a survey, right? So there's lots of differences. But what we saw, and I haven't seen any other research that has analyzed this. If you guys know, please send it my way. I'd love to read it. But I really wanted to look at who's getting accommodations granted based on your, you know, intersecting identities. And what we found is that, you know, when you compare disabled BIPOC employees, so people of color, to white disabled folks. So for example, like, you know, looking at women, looking at men, there's about a 10 percentage point differential, right? So about 44-ish percent of white disabled people are getting accommodations they ask for in the US fully granted, versus only about 33%, or like a third of, of BIPOC folks with disabilities, right? And it's not at all surprising, and that totally lines up with what members of the community will tell you. It's not all that different from, you know, what we see in the healthcare space in terms of, you know, the care and, you know, the care and treatment of people of color versus white folks in the healthcare arena. But, you know, if you're not acknowledging that is a gap, then you're just continuing to have biased, you know, HR accommodation policies. And so going back to the question of why does identity matter, I think at the most, like, literal level, like, identity matters because outcomes and experiences in the workplace and in society are different as a function of identity. And then, of course, there is also the, you know, like being able to bring yourself and all of the assets and perspectives and values to a place where maybe you're spending the majority of your waking hours. Like, that matters for, you know, what's going on in the four walls of your organization. And it also matters in terms of the value of the and the creativity of the products and services that you're delivering to your users and customers and constituents. So I could talk about this forever, but those were just the threads that like poked out of my brain when you said that, Deborah. Thank you.
Impressive thoughts. Neil, no. Antonio, I don't know.
I was about to follow on Deborah's question, but then you were able to bring the topic of HR, and I think probably there's a more relevant question to ask. You know, we all have business KPIs in many different areas. You know, sales as a business KPI. How can we make HR more accountable with KPIs to make sure that they don't discriminate? How can because I feel that they are getting away with it. And if you look back to the history of accessibility and even diversity and inclusion at the workplace, even if you go back 20 years, they seem to getting away with this for quite a long period of time.
Yeah. And so, I mean, I love this topic. You say KPIs, and as a consultant, I'm like, oh, sign me up. Love it. So I think two things. So one, I think it's always easy to like to kind of point a finger, you know, HR, what's HR doing? You know, what are the managers doing? What's the CEO doing? What's the DEI team doing? Like this, you know, Beverly Tatum has her analogy when it comes to race and anti-racism of like the moving walkway. It's like we're all on that moving walkway, right? We're like we ableism, just like racism, is a system that we all like we exist in it. And so it's everywhere, it's all around us. It's not, you know, one person or one group doing the doing. But, you know, Antonio, to your point, like if we're not collectively taking proactive steps, initiatives, implementing policies to actively work against that, then yeah, it's gonna keep pulling and then it's gonna show up in the KPIs and whatnot. I think tactically, you know, something that I've reflected on through this research and also just like what I do in my day job, like as a, you know, as a consultant for large complicated organizations. Like, so there are, there's a lot of different types of KPIs and metrics, right? You've got, you know, you've got kind of outcomes or maybe your North Star KPIs, and then you've got leading indicators. And so, you know, something like, okay, equity, we're gonna have equitable representation in senior leadership, women, people with disabilities, folks of color, like that is an outcome of lots of other things needing to fall in place. And there are a lot of leading indicators that can tell you like whether you're on track to that, both, okay, looking at, you know, what's the promotion and retention parity or lack thereof, like at every level, but then also, you know, using tools like surveys, using employee engagement, you know, mechanisms, such as, you know, the index that we used looking at, hey, are folks feeling included? And this goes back to some of the other research that I've done in our broader kind of people and organization space. But we clearly see a linkage between inclusion with retention. We clearly see, you know, when managers articulate their commitment to DE&I, their team members of all identities have a better workplace experience, feel more motivated, want to stay in organizations. And then those are the types of things over time that can lead to equity in outcomes, right? Of promotion, retention, representation at the top. But if you're just looking at, like a lot of companies, they'll, you know, they record and they even publish data on, okay, what's the representation, you know, of our workforce. But that's just scratching the surface. Like if that's all you're looking at, you're probably not going to get anywhere unless you're really intuitive and you just instinctively know where your gaps are and what different pockets of your employees are feeling.
So just a quick comment on that. So if you had to start a company today or advise someone today, where would you recommend that organization to have someone leading these topics. It will be at the C-suite level, CFO, CTO, CEO, or at the junior level. Is it important to because I know that some organizations have linked the responsibility for diversity, equity, and inclusion at the CFO level, others put it at the junior levels. Or how important is the fact that it sits at a higher level in order to make sure that escalate to all organization?
Yeah, so I mean, as so great question. As we, as I think I alluded to before, you know, we do see that organizations that, you know, make a heavier investment on like leadership level initiatives and support for you know, inclusion efforts, for ERGs, other initiatives that support diverse, you know, employees, the outcomes for employees are more positive. I mean, in terms of org, you know, org design, I've seen, you know, lots of examples of companies doing this in a number of different ways. But I think, you know, regardless of the positions, like having executive level leadership within you know, ERGs and for diversity and inclusion initiatives overall. So like a chief diversity officer, executive sponsors of your ERGs, like I think that all sends a really positive signal. I would say for accessibility and disability inclusion, I think organizations that only see this as an HR function, in my view, like not the right direction, because inclusion and disability inclusion and accessibility are both an internal and an external function, right? Thinking about the accessibility of your products for customers, as well as, you know, processes for your own employees. So, you know, in my view, like leadership at the top, taking a comprehensive and broad approach to thinking through accessibility, like those are some of the ingredients for doing this most effectively.
I can't but agree, you know, because within our own organization, you know, accessibility is a transversal topic. Thank you so much. There's so much we could go on talking about here that we're already 7 minutes over our schedule. I could keep going. It's been a real joy. We're going to have you back. I'm already mentally booking you in, but it's been great. We look forward to continuing the conversation on social media. It just remains for me to thank MyClearText for keeping us captioned and Amazon for also being our friends and helping keep us on it. We're in our 10th year and we're still going strong. So thank you, Hillary. It's been a real pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, Neil, Antonio, Deborah. It was just wonderful getting the chance to chat with you all, and eager to continue the conversation. Excited for the listeners, the viewers out there to check out our reports that Neil will make sure gets posted, I'm sure. Thank you.